This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. CBS and Initialism of the network's former name, the Columbia Broadcasting System is an American commercial broadcast television network that is a flagship property of CBS Corporation. The company is headquartered at the CBS Building in New York City with major production facilities and operations in New York City at the CBS Broadcast Center and Los Angeles at CBS Television City and the CBS Studio Center. CBS is sometimes referred to as the iNetwork, in reference to the company's iconic logo. In use since 1951, it has also been called the Tiffany Network, alluding to the perceived high quality of CBS programming during the tenure of its founder William S. Paley. It can also refer to some of CBS's first demonstrations of color television, which were held in a former Tiffany. Spin-off of CBS in 1971. In late 2005, Viacom split itself into two separate companies, and re-established CBS Corporation, through the spin-off of its broadcast television, radio and select cable television and non-broadcasting assets, with the CBS Television Network at its core. CBS Corporation is controlled by Sumner Redstone through National Amusements, which also controls the current Viacom. CBS continues to operate the CBS Radio Network, which now mainly provides news and features content for its portfolio of owned and operated radio stations in large and mid-sized markets, and affiliated radio stations in various other markets. The television network has more than 240 owned and operated and affiliated television stations throughout the United States. Contents 1 History 11 Radio Years 111 Turnaround, Paley's First Year 112 CBS Takes on the Red and the Blue 1930s 113 CBS Launches an Independent News Division 114 Panic, The War of the Worlds Radio Broadcast 115 CBS Recruits Edmund A. Chester 116 Zenith of Network Radio 1940s 117 Primetime Radio Gives Way to Television 1950s 118 CBS's Radio Programming After 1972 12 Television Years, Expansion and Growth 121 Programming 1945-1970 122 Programming, Rural Purge and Success in the 1970s and Early Mid-1980s 1971-86123 Programming, Tiffany Network in Distress 1986-2002 124 Programming, Return to First Place and Rivalry with Fox 2002 Present 125 CBS Television News Operations 126 Color Technology 1953-1967-2 Conglomerate 21 Columbia Records 22 Publishing 23 CBS Musical Instruments Division 24 Film Production 25 Home Video 26 Gabriel Toys 27 New Owners 271 Westinghouse Electric Corporation 272 Viacom 273 CBS Corporation and CBS Studios 3 Programming 31 Daytime 32 Children's Programming 33 Specials 331 Animated Primetime Holiday Specials 332 Classical Music Specials 333 Cinderella 334 National Geographic 335 Other Notable Specials 4 Stations 5 Related Services 51 Video On Demand Services 511 CBS All Access 52 CBS HD 6 Brand Identity 61 Logos 62 Image Campaigns 621 1980s 622 1990s 623 2063 Promos 7 International Broadcasts 71 India 72 Canada 73 Mexico 74 Guam 75 Europe 751 United Kingdom 76 Australia 77 Asia 771 Bermuda 772 Hong Kong 773 Philippines 774 India 8 Controversies 81 Brown. The origins of CBS date back to January 27, 1927, with the creation of the United Independent Broadcasters Network in Chicago by New York City talent agent Arthur Judson. The fledgling network soon needed additional investors though, and the Columbia Phonograph Company, manufacturers of Columbia Records, rescued it in April 1927. As a result, the network was renamed the Columbia Phonographic Broadcasting System. On September 18 of that year, Columbia Phonographic went on the air on September September 18, 1927, with a presentation by the Howard Barlow Orchestra from flagship station WOR in Newark, New Jersey, and 15 affiliates' operational costs were steep, particularly the payments to it. Turnaround, Paley's first year during Luschenheim's brief regime, Columbia paid $410,000 to Og Greeb's Atlantic Broadcasting Company for a small Brooklyn station, WABC, no relation to the current WABC, which would become the network's flagship station. WABC was quickly upgraded, and the signal relocated to 860 kHz. The physical plant was relocated also, to Steinway Hall on West 57th Street in Manhattan, where much of CBS's programming would originate. By the turn of 1929, the network could boast to sponsors of having 47 affiliates. Paley moved right away to put his network on a firmer financial footing in the fall of 1928. He entered into talks with Adolph Zukor of Paramount Pictures, who planned to move into radio in response to RCA's forays into motion pictures. With the advent of talkies, the deal came to fruition in September 1929. Paramount acquired 49% of CBS in return for a block of its stock worth $38 million at the time. The agreement specified that Paramount would buy that same stock back by March 1, 1932 for a flat $5 million, provided CBS had earned $2 million during 1931 and 1932. For a brief time, there was talk that the network might be renamed Paramount Radio, but it only lasted a month. The 1929 stock market crash sent all stock value tumbling. It galvanized Paley and his troops, who had no alternative but to turn the network around and earn the $2 million in 2 years. This is the atmosphere in which the CBS of today was born. The near-bankrupt movie studio sold its CBS shares back to CBS in 1932. In the first year of Paley's watch, CBS's gross earnings more than tripled, going from $14 million to $47 million. Paley's management saw a 20-fold increase in gross income in his first decade. Much of the increase was a result of Paley's second upgrade to the CBS business plan, improved affiliate relations. There were two types of program at the time, sponsored and sustaining, i.e., unsponsored rival NBC paid affiliates for every sponsored show they carried and charged them for every sustaining show they ran. It was onerous for small and medium stations, and resulted in both unhappy affiliates and limited carriage of sustaining programs. Paley had a different idea, designed to get CBS programs emanating from as many radio sets as possible. He would give the sustaining programs away for free, provided the station would run every sponsored show, and accept CBS's check for doing so. CBS soon had more affiliates than either NBC Red or NBC Blue. Paley was a man who valued style and taste, and in 1929, once he had his affiliates happy and his company's creditworthiness on the mend, he relocated his concern to sleek, new 485 Madison Avenue, the heart of the advertising community, right where Paley wanted his company to be, and where it would stay until its move to its own Eero Saarinen-designed headquarters, the CBS Building, in 1965. When his new landlords expressed skepticism about the network and its fly-by-night reputation, Paley overcame their qualms by inking a lease for $15. Million. CBS takes on the Red and the Blue. 1930s wholesome Kate Smith, Paley's choice for La Palina Hour, was unthreatening to home and hearth since NBC was the broadcast arm of radio set manufacturer RCA. Its chief David Sarnoff approached his decisions as both a broadcaster and as a hardware executive. NBC's affiliates had the latest RCA equipment, and were often the best established stations, or were on clear channel frequencies, yet Sarnoff's affiliates were mistrustful of him. Paley had no such split loyalties. His and his affiliate's success rose and fell with the quality of CBS programming. Paley had an innate, pitch-perfect sense of entertainment, a gift of the gods, an ear totally pure, wrote David Halberstam, knew what was good and would sell, what was bad and would sell, and what was good and would not sell, and he never confused one with another. As the 1930s loomed, Paley set about building the CBS talent stable. The network became the home of many popular musical and comedy stars, among them Jack Benny, Your Canada Dry humorist, Al Jolson, George Burns. Crosby immediately to a contract for a daily radio show, while the CBS primetime lineup featured music, comedy, and variety shows. The daytime schedule was a direct conduit into American homes, and into the hearts and minds of American women. For many, it was the bulk of their adult human contact during the course of the day. CBS time salesmen recognized early on that this intimate connection could be a bonanza for advertisers of female interest products starting in 1930. Astrologer Evangeline Adams would consult the heavens on behalf behalf of listeners who sent in their birthdays, a description of their problems, and a box top from sponsor Forhan's Toothpaste. The low-key murmuring of smooth-voiced Tony Wands, backed by a tender violin, made him a soulmate to millions of women on behalf of the R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company, whose cellophane-wrapped Camel cigarettes were as fresh as the dew that dawn spills on a field of clover. The most popular radio friend of all was M. Sale Taylor, the voice of experience, though his name was never uttered on air. Women mailed descriptions of the most intimate of relationship problems to the voice in the tens of thousands per week. Sponsors Mustrol Ointment and Haley's M.O. Laxative enjoyed sales increases of several 100% in just the first month of the voice of experience's run. When Charlie Chaplin finally allowed the world to hear his voice after 20 years of mime, he chose CBS's airwaves to do it on. As the decade progressed, a new genre joined the daytime lineup: serial dramas, soap operas, so named for the products that sponsored them, by way of the ad agencies that actually produced them, although the form, usually in quarter-hour episodes, proliferated widely in the mid and late 1930s. They all had the same basic premise, that characters fell into two categories, one those in trouble and two those who helped people in trouble. The helping hand figures were usually older. At CBS, Just Plain Bill brought human insight and Anacin pain reliever into households. Your Family and Mine came courtesy of Seal Test Dairy Products. Bachelor's Children first hawked Old Dutch Cleanser, then Wonder Bread. Aunt Jenny's Real Life Stories was sponsored by Spry Vegetable Shortening. Our Gal Sunday Anacin again. The Romance of Helen Trent. Angeles Cosmetics, Big Sister Rinso Laundry Soap, and many others filled the daytime ether. CBS West Coast headquarters reflected its industry stature while hosting its top Hollywood talent thanks to its daytime and primetime schedules. CBS prospered in the 1930s. In 1935, gross sales were $193 million, yielding a profit of $227 million by 1937. The network took in $287 million and had 114 affiliates, almost all of which cleared 100% of network-fed programming, thus keeping ratings and revenue high in 1938. CBS even acquired the American Record Corporation, parent of its one-time investor Columbia Records. In 1938, NBC and CBS each opened studios in Hollywood to attract the entertainment industry's top talent to their networks. NBC at Radio City on Sunset Boulevard and Vine Street, CBS two blocks away at Columbia Square. CBS launches an independent news division. The extraordinary potential of radio news showed itself in 1930, when CBS suddenly found itself with a live telephone connection to a prisoner called the Deacon, who described, from the inside and in real time, a riot and conflagration at the Ohio Penitentiary. For CBS, it was a shocking journalistic coup. Yet as late as 1934, there was still no regularly scheduled newscast on network radio. Most sponsors did not want network news programming. Those that did were inclined to expect veto rights over it. There had been a long-standing wariness between radio and the newspapers as well. The papers had rightly concluded that the upstart radio business would compete with them on two counts: advertising dollars and news coverage. By 1933, they fought back, many no longer publishing radio schedules for readers' convenience, or allowing their news to be read on the air for radio's profit. Radio, in turn, pushed back when urban department stores, newspapers' largest advertisers and themselves owners of many radio stations, threatened to withhold their ads from print. A short-lived attempted truce in 1933 even saw the papers proposing that radio be forbidden from running news before 9:30. Was 12 hours old. CBS news engineers prepare a remote. Justice Hugo Black's 1937 denial of Klan ties. It was in this climate that Paley set out to enhance the prestige of CBS, to make it seem in the public mind the more advanced, dignified and socially aware network. He did it through sustaining programming like the New York Philharmonic, the thoughtful drama of Norman Corwin, and an in-house news division to gather and present news, free of fickle suppliers like newspapers and wire services. In the fall of 1934, CBS launched an independent news division, shaped in its first years by Paley's vice president, former New York Times columnist Ed Klauber, and news director Paul White. Since there was no blueprint or precedent for real-time news coverage, early efforts of the new division used the shortwave link up CBS CBS had been using for 5 years to bring live feeds of European events to its American air. A key early hire was Edward R. Murrow in 1935. His first corporate title was director of talks. He was mentored in microphone technique by Robert Trout, the lone full-time member of the news division, and quickly found himself in a growing rivalry with boss White. Murrow was glad to leave the hothouse atmosphere of the New York office behind when he was dispatched to London as CBS's European director in 1937, a time when the growing Hitler menace underscored the need for a robust European bureau. Halberstam described Murrow in London as the right man in the right place in the right era. Murrow began assembling the staff of broadcast journalists, including William L. Shirer, Charles Collingwood, Bill Downs, and Eric Severide, who would become known as Murrow's Boys. They were, in own image, sartorially impeccable, literate, often liberal, and prima donnas all. They covered history in the making, and sometimes made it themselves. On March 12, 1938, Hitler boldly annexed nearby Austria, and Murrow and Boys quickly assembled coverage with Shirer in London, Edgar Ansel Maurer in Paris, Pierre Huss in Berlin, Frank Gervasi in Rome, and Trout in New York. This bore the news roundup format, which is still ubiquitous today in broadcast news. Murrow's nightly reports from the rooftops during the dark days of the London Blitz galvanized American listeners, even before Pearl Harbor. The conflict became the story of the survival of Western civilization, the most heroic of all possible wars and stories. He was indeed reporting on the survival of the English-speaking peoples. With his manly, tormented voice, Murrow contained and mastered the panic and danger he felt, thereby communicating it all the more effectively to his audience using his trademark self-reference. This reporter, he did not so much report news as interpret it, combining simplicity of expression with subtlety of nuance. Murrow himself said he tried to describe things in terms that make sense to the truck driver without insulting the intelligence of the professor. When he returned home for a visit late in 1941, Paley threw an extraordinarily elaborate reception for Murrow at the Waldorf Astoria. Of course, its goal was more than just honoring CBS's latest star. It was an announcement to the world that Mr. Paley's network was finally more than just a pipeline carrying other people's programming. It had now become a cultural force in its own right. Once the war was over and Murrow returned for good, it was as a superstar with prestige and freedom and respect within his profession and within his company. He possessed enormous capital within that company, and as the unknown form of television news loomed large, he would spend it freely, first in radio news, then in television, taking on Senator Joseph McCarthy first, then eventually William S. Paley himself, and with a foe that formidable, even the vast Murrow account would soon run dry. Panic, the War of the Worlds radio broadcast en font terrible. Orson Welles's Halloween joke frightened the country and snared a sponsor. On October 30, 1938, CBS gained a taste of infamy when the Mercury Theater on the air broadcast a radio adaptation of H.G. Wells's The War of the Worlds, performed by Orson Welles. Its unique format, a contemporary version of the story in the form of faux news broadcasts, had panicked many listeners into believing invaders from Mars were actually invading and devastating Grover's Mill, New Jersey, despite three disclaimers during the broadcast that it was a work of fiction. The flood of publicity after the broadcast had two effects: an FCC ban on faux news bulletins within dramatic programming, and sponsorship for the Mercury Theater on the air. The former sustaining program became the Campbell Playhouse to sell soup. Wells, for his part, summarized the episode as the Mercury Theater's own radio version of dressing up in a sheet and jumping out of a bush and saying, "Boo." CBS recruits Edmund A. Chester before the onset of World War II. In 1940, CBS recruited Edmund A. Chester from his position as bureau chief for Latin America at the Associated Press to serve as director of Latin American relations and director of shortwave broadcasts for the CBS radio network. In this capacity, Mr. Chester coordinated the development of the network of the Americas, La Cadena de las Americas, with the Department of State, the Office for Inter-American Affairs as chaired by Nelson Rockefeller and Voice of America. This network provided vital news and cultural programming throughout South America and Central America during the crucial World War II era and fostered diplomatic relations between the United States and the less developed nations of the continent. It featured such popular radio broadcasts as Viva America, which showcased leading musical talent from both North and South America, accompanied by the CBS Pan American Orchestra under the musical direction of Alfredo Antonini. The post-war era also marked the beginning of CBS's dominance in the field of radio as well. Zenith of network radio. 1940s as 1939 wound down, Bill Paley announced that 1940 would be the greatest year in the history of radio in the United States. He turned out to be right by more than anyone could imagine. The decade of the 1940s would indeed be the apogee of network radio by every gauge. Nearly 100% of the advertisers who made sponsorship deals in 1939 renewed their contracts for 1940. Manufacturers of farm tractors made radios standard equipment on their machines. Wartime rationing of paper limited the size of newspapers, and effectively advertisements, and when papers turned them away, they migrated to radio sponsorship. A 1942 act by Congress made advertising expenses a tax benefit, and that sent even automobile and tire manufacturers, who had no products to sell since they had been converted to war production, scurrying to sponsor symphony orchestras and serious drama on radio. In 1940, only one-third of radio programs were sponsored, while two-thirds were sustaining. By the middle of the decade, the statistics had swapped. Two out of three shows now had cash-paying sponsors, and only one-third were sustaining. The CBS of the 1940s was vastly different from that of the early days. Many of the old guard veterans had died, retired, or simply left the network. No change was greater than that in Paley himself. He had become difficult to work for, and had gradually shifted from leader to despot. He spent much of his time seeking social connections and in cultural pursuits. His hope was that CBS could somehow learn to run itself. His brief to an interior designer remodeling his townhouse included a requirement for closets that would accommodate 300 suits, 100 shirts, and had special racks for 100 neckties. Dr. Frank Stanton, second only to Paley in his impact on CBS, President 1946-1971. As Paley grew more remote, he installed a series of buffer executives who sequentially assumed more and more power at CBS, first Ed Klauber, then Paul Kesson, and finally Frank Stanton, second only to Paley as the author of CBS's style and ambitions in its first half century. Stanton was a magnificent mandarin who functioned as company superintendent, spokesman, and image maker. He had come to the network in 1933 after sending copies of his PhD thesis, A Critique of Present Methods and a New Plan for Studying Radio Listening Behavior, to CBS top brass, and they responded with a job offer. He scored an early hit with his study, Memory for Advertising Copy, presented visually versus orally, which CBS salesmen used to great effect, bringing in new sponsors in 1946. Paley appointed Stanton as president of CBS and promoted himself to chairman. Stanton's colorful, but impeccable wardrobe, slate blue pinstripe suit, ecru shirt, robin's egg blue necktie with splashes of saffron, made him, in the mind of one sardonic CBS vice president, the greatest argument we have for color television. Despite the influx of advertisers and their cash, or perhaps because of them, the 1940s were not without bumps for the radio networks. The biggest challenge came in the form of the FCC's chain broadcasting investigation, the monopoly probe, as it was often called, though it started in 1938. The investigation only gathered steam in 1940 under new broom chairman James L. Fly. By the time the smoke had cleared in 1943, NBC had already spun off its Blue Network, which became the American Broadcasting Company. ABC CBS was also hit, though not as severely. Paley's brilliant 1928 affiliate contract, which had given CBS first claim on local stations air during sponsored time, the network option, came under attack as being restrictive to local programming. The final compromise permitted the network option for 3 out of 4 hours during certain dayparts, but the new regulations had virtually no practical effect, since most all stations accepted the network feed, especially the sponsored hours that earned them money. Fly's panel also forbade networks from owning artists' representation bureaus, so CBS sold its bureau to Music Corporation of America and it became Management Corporation of America. Arthur Godfrey spoke directly to listeners individually, making him a foremost pitchman into TV era on the air. The war affected almost every show. Variety shows wove patriotism through their comedy and music segments. Dramas and soaps had characters join the service and go off to fight even before hostilities commenced in Europe. One of the most played songs on radio was Irving Berlin's God Bless America, popularized by CBS personality Kate Smith. Although an office of censorship sprang up within days of Pearl Harbor, censorship would be totally voluntary. Few shows submitted scripts for review, most did not. The guidelines that the office did issue banned weather reports, including announcement of sports rainouts, news about troop, ship or plane movements, war production, and live man-on-the-street interviews. The ban on ad-libbing caused quizzes, game shows, and amateur hours to wither for the duration. Surprising was the granite permanence of the shows at the top of the ratings. The vaudevillians and musicians who were hugely popular after the war were the same stars who had been huge in the 1930s: Jack Benny, Bing Crosby, Harvey, Burns and Allen, and Edgar Bergen all had been on the radio almost as long as there had been network radio. A notable exception to this was relative newcomer Arthur Godfrey, who, as late as 1942, was still doing a local morning show in Washington, D.C. Godfrey, who had been a cemetery lot salesman and a cab driver, pioneered the style of talking directly to the listener as an individual, with a singular "you" rather than phrases like "now, folks" or "yes, friends." His combined shows contributed as much as 12% of all CBS revenues. By 1948, he was pulling down $500,000 a year. In 1947, Paley, still the undisputed head talent scout of CBS, led a much publicized talent raid on NBC one day, while Freeman Gosden and Charles Carell were hard at work at NBC writing their venerable Amos and Andy show. A knock came on the door. It was Paley himself, with an astonishing offer: "Whatever you are getting now, I will give you twice as much." Capturing NBC's cornerstone show was enough of a coup, but Paley repeated in 1948 with longtime NBC stars Edgar Bergen, Charlie McCarthy and Red Skelton, as well as former CBS defectors Jack Benny, radio's top-rated comedian, and Burns and Allen. Paley achieved this route with a legal agreement reminiscent of his 1928 contract that caused some NBC radio affiliates to jump ship and join CBS. CBS would buy the stars' names as a property, in exchange for a large lump sum and a salary. The plan relied on the vastly different tax rates between income and capital gains, so not only would the stars enjoy more than twice their income after taxes, but CBS would preclude any NBC counterattack because CBS owned the performers' names. As a result of this, Paley got in 1949 something he had sought for 20 years. CBS finally beat NBC in the ratings, but it was not just to one-up rival Sarnoff that Paley led his talent raid. He, and all of radio, had their eye on the coming force that threw a shadow over radio throughout the 1940s. Television primetime radio gives way to television 1950s. Frank Stanton, President 1946-1971, Louis G. Cowan, President 1957-1959, James Thomas Aubrey, President 1959-1965. A 1951 advertisement for the CBS television network introduced the I logo in the spring of 1940. CBS staff engineer Peter Goldmark devised a system for color television that CBS management hoped would leapfrog the network over NBC and its existing black and white RCA system. The CBS system gave brilliant and stable colors, while NBC's was crude and unstable but compatible. Ultimately, the FCC rejected the CBS system because it was incompatible with RCA's, that, and the fact that CBS had moved to secure many UHF, not VHF, television licenses, left CBS flat-footed in the early television age. In 1946, only 6,000 television sets were in operation, most in Greater New York City, where there were already three stations. By 1949, the number had increased to 3 million sets, and by 1951, had risen to 12 million. 64 American cities had television stations, though most of them only had one. Radio continued to be the backbone of the company, at least in the early 1950s, but it was a strange twilight period. NBC's venerable Fred Allen saw his ratings plummet when he was pitted against upstart ABC's game show Stop the Music. Within weeks, he was dropped by longtime sponsor Ford Motor Company and was shortly gone from the scene. Radio powerhouse Bob Hope's ratings plunged from a 238 share in 1949 to 54 in 1953. By 1952, death seemed imminent for network radio in its familiar form. Most telling of all, the big sponsors were eager for the switch gradually. As the television network took shape, radio stars began to migrate to the new medium. Many programs ran on both media while making the transition. The radio soap opera The Guiding Light moved to television in 1952 and ran another 57 years. Burns continued simultaneously on radio for its full television life. The high-rated Jack Benny program ended its radio run in 1955, and Edgar Bergen's Sunday Night Show went off the air in 1957 when CBS announced in 1956 that its radio operations had lost money. While the television network had made money, it was clear where the future lay when the soap opera Ma Perkins went off the air on November 25, 1960. Only eight, relatively minor series remained. Primetime radio ended on September 30, 1962, when Yours Truly, Johnny Dollar and Suspense aired for the final time. CBS's radio programming after 1972. The retirement of Arthur Godfrey in April 1972 marked the end of long-form programming on CBS radio. Programming thereafter consisted of hourly news summaries and news features, known in the 1970s as Dimension, and commentaries, including the Spectrum series that evolved into the Point Counterpoint feature on the television network's 60 Minutes and First Line Report, a news and analysis feature delivered by CBS correspondents. The network also continued to offer traditional radio programming through its weeknightly CBS Radio Mystery Theater, the lone sustained holdout of dramatic programming, from 1974 to 1982. Though shorter runs were given to the General Mills Radio Adventure Theater and the Sears Radio Theater in the 1970s, otherwise, most new dramatic radio was carried on public and to some extent religious stations. The CBS Radio Network continues to this day, offering hourly newscasts, including its centerpiece CBS World News Roundup in the morning and evening, weekend sister program CBS News Weekend Roundup, the news-related feature segment The Osgood File, What's in the News, a one-minute summary of one story, and various other segments such as commentary from Seattle radio personality Dave Ross, tip segments from various other sources, and technology coverage from CBS interactive property CNET. CBS is the last of the original Big Four radio networks to continue to be owned by its founding company, although the CBS parent itself ceased to exist when it was acquired by Westinghouse Electric in 1995. CBS Radio continues to be operated by CBS. In contrast, ABC Radio was sold to Citadel Broadcasting in 2007 and is now a part of Cumulus Media, while Mutual, now defunct, and NBC Radio were acquired by Westwood One in the 1980s. Westwood One and CBS were under common ownership from 1993 to 2007. The former would be acquired outright by Dial Global in October 2011. Television years, expansion and growth. CBS headquarters in New York City. CBS's involvement in television dates back to the opening of experimental station W2XAB in New York City on July 21, 1931, using the mechanical television system that had been more or less perfected in the late 1920s. Its initial broadcast featured New York Mayor Jimmy Walker, Kate Smith, and George Gershwin. The station boasted the first regular seven-day broadcasting schedule in American television, broadcasting 28 hours a week. Announcer-director Bill Shutt was the station's only paid employee. All other talent was volunteer. W2XAB pioneered program development, including small-scale dramatic acts, monologues, pantomime, and the use of projection slides to simulate sets. Engineer Bill Lodge devised the first synchronized sound wave for a television station in 1932, enabling W2XAB to broadcast picture and sound on a single shortwave channel instead of the two previously needed. On November 8, 1932, W2XAB broadcast the first television coverage of presidential election returns. The station suspended operations on February 20, 1933, as monochrome television transmission standards were in flux, and in the process of changing from a mechanical to an all-electronic system. W2XAB returned to the air with an all-electronic system in 1939 from a new studio complex in Grand Central Station and a transmitter atop the Chrysler Building. Broadcasting on Channel 2, W2XAB transmitted the first color broadcast in the United States on August 28, 1940. On June 24, 1941, W2XAB received a commercial construction permit and program authorization as WCBW. The station went on the air at 2:30. To be the first. During the World War II years, commercial television broadcasting was reduced dramatically toward the end of the war. Commercial television began to ramp up again, with an increased level of programming evident from 1944 to 1947 on the three New York television stations which operated in those years, the local stations of NBC, CBS, and DuMont. But as RCA and DuMont raced to establish networks and offer upgraded programming, CBS lagged, advocating an industry-wide shift and restart to UHF for their incompatible with black and white color system, the FCC putting an indefinite freeze on television licenses that lasted until 1952 also did not help matters. Only in 1950, when NBC was dominant in television and black and white transmission was widespread, did CBS begin to buy or build their own stations outside of New York City and Los Angeles, Chicago, and other major cities. Up to that point, CBS programming was seen on such stations as KTTV in Los Angeles, which CBS CBS, as a bit of insurance and to guarantee program clearance in that market, quickly purchased a 50% interest in that station, partnering with the Los Angeles Times newspaper. CBS then sold its interest in KTTV, now the West Coast flagship of the Fox network, and purchased outright Los Angeles pioneer station KTSL in 1950, renaming it KNXT after CBS's existing Los Angeles radio property, KNX, later to become KCBS-TV in 1953. CBS bought pioneer television station WBKB in Chicago, which had been signed on by former investor Paramount Pictures and would become a sister company to CBS again decades later as a commercial station in 1946, and changed that station's call sign to WBBM-TV, moving the CBS affiliation away from WGN-TV. WCBS-TV would ultimately be the only station as of 2013 built and signed on by CBS. The rest of the stations would be acquired by CBS, either in an ownership stake or outright purchase in television's early years. The network bought Washington, D.C. affiliate WOIC, now WUSA, in a joint venture with the Washington Post in 1950, only to sell its stake to the Post in 1954 due to then tighter FCC ownership regulations. CBS would also temporarily return to relying on its own UHF technology by owning WXIX in Milwaukee, now CW affiliate WVTV, and WHCT in Hartford, Connecticut, now Univision affiliate WUVN, but as UHF was not viable for broadcasting at the time due to the fact that most television sets of the time were not equipped with UHF tuners. CBS decided to sell those stations off and affiliate with VHF stations WITI and WTIC-TV, now WFSB, respectively. Ironically, CBS would later be forced back onto UHF in Milwaukee due to the affiliation agreement with New World Communications that resulted in WITI disaffiliating from the network in 1994 to join Fox. It is now affiliated with WDJT-TV in that market more long-term. CBS bought stations in Philadelphia WCAU, now owned by NBC, and St. Louis KMOX-TV, now KMOV, but CBS would eventually sell these stations off as well. Before buying KMOX-TV, CBS had attempted to purchase and sign on the Channel 11 license in St. Louis, now KPLR-TV. CBS did attempt to sign on a station in Pittsburgh after the freeze was lifted, as that city was then the sixth largest market but only had one commercial VHF station in Dumont-owned WDTV, while the rest were either on UHF, the modern-day WPGH-TV and WINP-TV, or public television WQED. Although the FCC turned down CBS's request to buy the Channel 9 license in nearby Steubenville, Ohio, and move it to Pittsburgh, that station, initially CBS affiliate WSTV-TV, is now NBC affiliate WTOV-TV. CBS did score a major coup when Pittsburgh-based Westinghouse Electric, a co-founder of NBC with RCA, bought WDTV from struggling Dumont and opted to affiliate the now-recalled KDKA-TV with CBS instead of NBC, like KDKA Radio, due to NBC extorting and coercing Westinghouse to trade KYW Radio and WPTZ, now KYW-TV, for Cleveland stations WTAM, WTAM-FM, now WMJI, and WNBK, now WKYC. The trade ended up being reversed in 1965 by order of the FCC and the United States Department of Justice after an eight-year investigation. Had CBS not been able to affiliate with KDKA-TV, it would have affiliated with eventual NBC affiliate WIIC-TV, now WPXI, once it signed on in 1957. Instead, this coup would eventually lead to a much stronger relationship between Westinghouse and CBS decades later, programming 1945-1970 The Talent Raid on NBC of the mid-1940s had brought over established radio stars, who became stars of CBS television programs as well. One reluctant CBS star refused to bring her radio show, My Favorite Husband, to television unless the network would recast the show with her real-life husband in the lead. I Love Lucy debuted in October 1951, and was an immediate sensation, with 11 million out of a population of 15 million television sets watching 73% share. Paley and network president Frank Stanton had so little faith in the future of Lucille Ball's series, that they granted her wish and allowed her husband, Dacey Arnaz, to take financial control of the comedy's production. This was the making of the Ball-Arnaz-Desilu empire, and became the template for series production to this day. It also served as the template for some television conventions that continue to exist, including the use of a multiple cameras to film scenes, the use of a studio audience, and the airing of past episodes for syndication to other television outlets. As television came to the forefront of American entertainment and information, CBS dominated television as it once had radio in 1953. The CBS television network would make its first profit, and would maintain dominance on television between 1955 and 1976 as well. By the late 1950s, the network often controlled 7 or 8 of the slots on the top 10 ratings list, with well-respected shows like Route 66 during the presidency of James T. Aubrey 1958-1965. CBS was able to balance prestigious television projects befitting the Tiffany Network image, with more low-culture, broad-appeal programs, so the network had challenging fare like The Twilight Zone 1959 TV series, The Defenders 1961 TV series, and East Side, West Side, as well as The Andy Griffith Show, The Beverly Hillbillies, Gomer Pyle, USMC, and Gilligan's Island. This success would continue for many years, with CBS being bumped from first place only due to the rise of ABC in the mid-1970s, perhaps because of its status as the top-rated network. During the late 1960s and early 1970s, CBS felt freer to gamble with controversial properties like the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour and All in the Family and its many spin-offs during this period. Programming, Rural Purge, and success in the 1970s and early mid-1980s. 1971-86 main article, Rural Purge. By the end of the 1960s, CBS was very successful in television ratings, but many of its shows, including The Beverly Hillbillies, Mayberry RFD, Petticoat Junction, Hee Haw, and Green Acres, were appealing more to older and more rural audiences and less to the young, urban, and more affluent audiences that advertisers sought to target. Fred Silverman, who would later head ABC, and then later NBC, made the decision to cancel most of those otherwise hit shows by mid-1971 in what became colloquially referred to as the Rural Purge, with Green Acres cast member Pat Buttram remarking that the network canceled anything with a tree in it. While the Rural shows got the axe, new hits, like The Mary Tyler Moore Show, All in the Family, The Bob Newhart Show, Cannon, Barnaby Jones, Kojak, and The Sunny. Early 1970s, the majority of these hits were overseen by then East Coast Vice President Alan Wagner. 60 Minutes also moved to the 7 o'clock. Based on its earlier hits and some new ones, One Day at a Time, Alice, Lou Grant, WKRP in Cincinnati, The Dukes of Hazzard, a suspiciously rural series, and the biggest hit of the early 1980s, Dallas, the latter of which holds the record for the all-time most watched non-series finale single U.S. television episode, the November 21, 1980 primetime telecast of the resolution episode of the internationally prominent Who Shot Jr. cliffhanger. By 1982, ABC had run out of steam. NBC was in dire straits, with many failed programming efforts greenlighted by Silverman during his tenure as network president, a four-year run which began in 1978, and CBS once more nosed ahead, courtesy of the major success of Dallas and its spin-off Knots Landing, as well as hits in Falcon Crest, Magnum, Pie, Simon. Tisch. Consequently, collaboration between Paley and Tisch led to the slow dismissal of Wyman, with Tisch taking over as chief operating officer, and Paley returning as chairman programming. Tiffany Network in distress. 1986-2002. By the end of the 1987-88 season, CBS had fallen to third place behind both ABC and NBC for the first time, and had some major rebuilding to do. In 1984, The Cosby Show and Miami Vice debuted on NBC and immediately garnered high ratings, helping to bring that network back to first place by the 1985-86 season with a slate that included several other hits such as Amen, Family Ties, Cheers, The Golden Girls, L.A. Law, and 227. ABC had in turn also rebounded with hits such as Dynasty, Who's the Boss, Hotel, Growing Pains, The Wonder Years, and Roseanne. Some of the groundwork had been laid as CBS fell in the ratings, with hit Simon. Association to NBC after the 1989-90 NBA season under network president Jeff Sagansky, the network was able to earn strong ratings from new shows Diagnosis, Murder, Touched by an Angel, Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman, Walker, Texas Ranger, and a resurgent Jake and the Fat Man during this period, and CBS was able to reclaim the first place crown briefly, in the 1992-93 season. However, a drawback for the network during this time frame was that its programming slate skewed towards an older demographic demographic than ABC, NBC, or even Fox, with its relatively limited presence at that time. A joke even floated around that CBS was the network for the living dead. During this period in 1993, the network made a breakthrough in establishing a successful late-night talk show franchise to compete with NBC's The Tonight Show when it signed David Letterman away from NBC after the late-night host was passed over as Johnny Carson's successor on Tonight in favor of Jay Leno despite having success with Late Show with David Letterman. 1993 saw the network suffer to a time where television changed forever. The network lost the rights to two major sports leagues. The network terminated its contract with Major League Baseball after losing approximately $500 million over a four-year span, with the league reaching a new contract with NBC and ABC then on December 17th of that year, in a move that surprised many media analysts and television viewers. Fox, then a fledgling network that in its then 7 years on the air had begun to accrue several popular programs in the Nielsen Top 20 alongside its established counterparts, outbid CBS for the broadcast rights to the National Football Conference, stripping the elder network of National Football League game telecasts for the first time since CBS began broadcasting games from the pre-merger NFL in 1955. Fox bid $158 billion for the NFC television rights, significantly higher than CBS's reported offer of $290 million to retain the contract. The acquisition of the NFC rights, which took effect with the 1994 NFL season, and which led to CBS being nicknamed "Can't Broadcast Sports," resulted in Fox striking a series of affiliation deals with longtime affiliates of each of the Big Three networks. CBS bore the brunt of the switches, with many of its existing affiliates being lured away by Fox, especially those owned by New World Communications, which Fox struck its largest affiliation deal with, while most of the stations that CBS ended up affiliating with to replace the previous affiliates it lost to Fox were former Fox affiliates and independent stations, most of which had limited to no local news presence prior to joining CBS. The network attempted to fill the loss of NFL by going after the rights to the National Hockey League. However, when CBS countered with a bid, Fox also outbid the network for the NHL rights. The loss of the NFL, along with an ill-fated effort to court younger viewers, led to a drop in CBS's ratings. One of the shows that was affected was The Late Show with David Letterman, which saw its viewership decline in large part due to the affiliation switches, at times even landing in third place in its timeslot behind ABC's Nightline. As a result, NBC's The Tonight Show with Jay Leno, which The Late Show often dominated over during the first 2 years of that show's run, became the top-rated late-night talk show still. CBS was able to produce some hits during the mid-1990s, such as The Nanny, JAG, which moved to the network from NBC, Chicago Hope, Cosby, Cybill, Touched by an Angel, and Everybody Loves Raymond. CBS attempted to court families on Fridays with the launch of a family-oriented comedy block, the CBS Block Party, in the 1997-98 season, consisting of Family Matters, Step by Step, Mego, and The Gregory Hines Show, all but the latter coming from Miller Boyett Productions, which had maintained a relationship with ABC during the late 1980s and 1990s. The lineup failed to compete against ABC's TGIF lineup, which saw its own viewership erode that season. Mego and Hines were cancelled by November, while Family Matters and Step by Step were put on hiatus and ended their runs in the summer of 1998. That winter, CBS aired its last Olympic Games to date with its telecast of the 1998 Winter Games in Nagano. NBC, which had already held the rights to the Summer Olympics since 1988, took over coverage of the Winter Olympics beginning with the 2002 Games. The building blocks for the network's return to the top of the ratings were put in place in 1997, when CBS regained the NFL through its acquisition of the broadcast television rights to the American Football Conference, stripping that package from NBC after 32 years, effective with the 1998 season. The contract was struck shortly before the AFC's emergence as the dominant NFL conference over the NFC, spurred in part by the turnaround of the New England Patriots in the 2000s with the help of the AFC package. CBS surpassed NBC for first place in the 1999-2000 season. However, it was beaten by ABC the following year. The network gained additional hits in the late 1990s and early 2000s with series such as The King of Queens, Nash Bridges, Judging Amy, Becker and Yes, Dear programming, returned to first place in rivalry with Fox 2002 present. Another turning point for CBS came in the summer of 2000 when it debuted the summer reality shows Survivor and Big Brother, which became surprise summer hits for the network in January 2001. CBS debuted the second season of Survivor after its broadcast of Super Bowl 35 and scheduled it on Thursdays at 8 o'clock. Christine, Rules of Engagement and The Big Bang Theory. The network's programming slate, buoyed largely by the success of CSI, briefly led the network to retake first place in the ratings from NBC in the 2002-03 season. The decade also saw CBS finally make ratings headway on Friday nights, a perennial weak spot for the network, with a focus toward drama series such as Ghost Whisperer and the relatively short-lived but critically acclaimed Joan of Arcadia. CBS became the most-watched American broadcast television network once again in the 2005-06 season, an achievement that the network proclaimed in on-air promotions as being America's most watched network, a term it would use again in the 2011-12 season. This lasted until the 2007-08 season, when Fox overtook CBS for first, becoming the first non-Big Three network to earn the title as the most watched network overall in the United States. Despite CBS's continued strong lineup, Fox's first place finish that season was primarily due to its reliance on American Idol, the longest-reigning number one primetime U.S. television program from 2004 to 2011. CBS retook its place as the top-rated network in the 2008-09 season, where it has remained every season since. Fox and CBS, both having ranked as the highest-rated of the major broadcast networks during the 2000s, tend to nearly equal one another in the 18-34, 18-49, and 25-54 demographics, with either network alternating in placing first in either of these groups by very close margins. NCIS, which has been the flagship of CBS's Tuesday lineup for much of its run, became the network's highest-rated drama by the 2007-08 season.